Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I'd like to welcome everyone to our morning meeting of the Alamance County Commissioners. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we do thank you, Lord, for just attending to our every need. And Lord, as we come to you now, Father, I just thank you for the life of John Patterson and his public service. And Father, I just lift that family up to you now in our prayers. And Lord, we just pray now for this meeting as we attend to the business of those that we serve. Father, guide us and direct us in this endeavor. And these things, Lord, I do pray in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand for the pledge.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, public speakers, John Paisley.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
We lost a really good friend, Friday. John Knox Patterson was one of my close friends. He's the reason I'm here today. In the spring semester of 1969, I was a junior at Elon College. And in the middle of a lecture, he said, "And Mr. Paisley, see me after class." I have no idea what happened for the next half an hour. I'm thinking, what am I doing? Yeah. And he wanted to talk to me about going to law school. My third year of law school, I don't know how he found my telephone number, called me up and said, "What are you going to do next year when you pass? Oh, this summer when you pass the bar exam?" I said, "I don't know. I just been on two interviews." He said, "You're coming to Alamance County," and I did. What a wonderful guy. He did so much for this county. The highest of lawyers, he was sworn into the United States Supreme Court, or as David and I call them, the Supremes. He was a county commissioner for 10 years. He was the chair of the county commissioners for a good portion of those years. He has done so much for this county. He has recognized so much talent. Many of you, David particularly, Dan, you for example, were so influenced by John Patterson. I can't say enough positive about him. I understand that you may do something here today to recognize him, so I was going to request that you do that. I think that my request is unnecessary. Just a wonderful guy. Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have Mr. Tony Cox.
You know, this morning I was running late. I was watching a video of Bob Simon where he was interviewing Dutch officers from Bosnia, the peacekeepers that was there to protect the people that got slaughtered. Last week on Survivor, the CBS hit series, white collar, blue collar, no collar. The test was, there's two sacks of beans, honesty, deception. Blue collar and no collar, they chose honesty. White collar chose deception. If you use that test in America, I think more times than not you'll come up with the same result. It's amazing what white-collar people will do to try to cover up and to say bad things about others. We've got a lot of problems, a lot of problems. I seen in a newspaper article where our DA and our sheriff stood up and said, and people, we know this, if you're dirty, it's going to come. So standing for our Constitution and saying we got some problems and turning those people loose, one of two things will either happen. One of the things is they'll say, I'll do better. The other thing is they'll continue to be dirty. And when you're dirty, it's going to come. But I applaud the sheriff. I applaud the DA for standing up for our Constitution. Now, I'm sure that there's some judge, like that one that I spoke about last year, will say, oh, yeah, you're going to be here. I'm sure there's a judge out there that will turn our laws into their laws that'll say, hey, I don't care, bring him to me, I'll show him, I'll teach him, I'll put him in prison, I'll shut him up, or her. The thing I wonder, though, is if there's just one innocent person out of that group, and when that innocent person, if there is one, comes up and says, hey, I've got the stuff to prove it, I just wonder if our county attorney over there will say, forget about what we've done, go on and shut your mouth, or we're going to lock you up.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Commissioner responses.
Mr. Chairman, if I,
yes, sir.
If I may follow up on what John was saying about John Patterson. He, in 1973, I came back home after practicing law in Guilford County and working for a bank in Henderson County, and somebody directed me to John, and John helped me get started practicing law here in Alamance County, and I practiced with John for 15 years or so. And John was a classmate of Governor Holzhauser. He and Howard Coble both were classmates of Governor Holzhauser. And I think I've told you about how much Howard helped me. Well, John did too. And during the time I was with John, he and Howard got me appointed Superior Court judge. And then in, I think it's 1996, John was a county commissioner when the board hired me as county attorney. So he not only helped John, but he helped people, young lawyers all the time in Alamance County. Didn't matter what political party they belonged to, everybody liked John. He was president of the Bar Association. He was chairman here for 7 straight years and decided not to run after 10 years, I think, on the board. Mr. Chairman, if I may, I would suggest that this board approve lowering the flag for John.
By consensus, those in favor, just raise your hand. Thank you, Judge. And
thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. And any further comments?
Well, I had John as a teacher at Elon also, and took business law under him and had a lot of experience in the real estate world with him because he was one of the cheaper lawyers in town doing closings. So he was a fine fellow, though. He was just a good guy.
John would probably tell you, and the judge knows this, that he was a Republican early on when there wasn't many in Alamance County that would be 6 or 8 that would sit around the table and look at each other, and that was pretty much the Republican Party early on, and he came up and just a true gentleman. I know in the paper somebody was quoted saying they never heard him say an unkind word about anybody. I never did. He was always a person, as
you
know, much stated, was top notch and was there to be helpful in any way that he could in a true public service, and he will be truly missed.
Let me add that,
yes,
how strong a Republican John was, his whole family was forever, I think, way on back 100 years or more. Knox is his middle name, and I asked him one time, was Knox a family name of some kind? He said no. He said my dad was a Republican And Mr. Knox was the vice presidential candidate in 1936 against President Roosevelt. So his dad and mother named him John Knox Patterson.
How about that? Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, just to make sure we do the wishes of the board, would you like us to the county flag at for the rest of the week through Friday? Is that the wishes? I want to make sure we...
Is that acceptable?
That's fine. That's protocol.
It'll be half mast until Friday.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Any further comments? Thank you, members. Approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion to approve the agenda for today?
I'll move.
Second it.
Moving to second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those do. Thank you. Consent agenda. Pretty lengthy today. Are there any items that any board member would like to see withheld from the consent agenda for discussion?
I'd like to pull B2 for the sheriff. I'd like to tell us about his trip he's getting ready to take here.
All right, sir. B2. Any others?
Yeah.
All right. With the exception of B2, do I have a motion that for approval of the consent agenda?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion and second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those who? Thank you. Item B2, out-of-state travel request, Sheriff's Office, Sheriff Johnson. And Sheriff, one second, please. We have some members that we just voted to approve on the planning board. And
yeah, we do.
Other boards would like to thank you for being here and thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, Sheriff.
Good morning, gentlemen. We're asking that a group of my officers, along with the district attorney, assistant district attorney, be allowed to travel to Dallas, Texas, to a crime against women conference. We have, because of our lack of manpower in the sheriff's department, we have combined our human trafficking unit, domestic violence, juvenile crimes, and sex offender unit into a special victims unit. Also, we are working with the district attorney's office to try to get better prosecution on these cases where the people won't be repeat offenders. And even I am one of them going out there. And the reason I'm going, because we're going to go to school and we're going to learn. There's a heck of an array of workshops, and we'll be dividing up individuals going to these different workshops, because there's no way we all can go to the same one. Then in the evenings, we'll come back together and discuss what went on in all these workshops and how we can apply that to the Family Justice Center and Alamance County law enforcement here in Alamance County. Some of the world-renowned teachers and speakers are putting on this conference, and that's one of the reasons. You know, I said if we had a training center in Alamance County, we could bring those people here and save some money, but we don't have it.
We've got Alamance Community College available at any time, sure.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, but they got to pay to bring them here.
Well, this is good. I think there's become awareness against crimes against women, and it looks like you have some really good speakers going to be there, and I think this will be money well spent.
We have got to do something, because I would say probably 70% of our call volume is domestic violence related. And with that comes juvenile issues, even human trafficking, sex offenders, etc. So we have got to do something. We can't keep coming to the commissioners, I need more manpower, I need more manpower, I need more manpower. We've got to learn to operate more efficiently.
Well, I commend you for doing that. And also, I noticed Cindy's here from Family Justice. We set the bar pretty high for other counties and other states to look at in our Family Justice, and I think this would be an integral part to that.
I do too. This whole issue about human trafficking, I'm beginning to learn more and more about it, and it's an issue that needs to be addressed, and I think this will help.
Yes, sir, absolutely.
And this is already something the funding of this is coming out of your budget. It's not additional funds.
That's exactly right.
All right, thank you. Any further comments? No. Do I have a motion for approval of the
Make a motion to approve.
A second.
Second.
Second. Judge, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you, Sheriff. All right, moving on to presentation, other business, item number seven. Tax liens and delinquent accounts. Jeremy Higgins.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Morning, sir.
Good morning.
Thanks for having me today. I've got the annual advertisement. Every year, individuals who have not paid in a timely fashion, who are delinquent, become advertised in the newspaper. Now, historically, we have splitter advertisements. Some go in the Times News, some go in the Alamance News. We do regionalize them a little bit, and it does help us some with our costs. That is the plan to continue to do this year. March 19th is the expected date of advertisement, so we're trying to get everything together for that, which means if there's anyone watching the meeting that has unpaid taxes, this is kind of a last-ditch attempt to get it done before names go in. Obviously, we don't want to put people's names in the paper, but it is part of our process. There is no cost net at the end of the day for the county to do this because there is a fee associated. Anyone that ends up being advertised has, I'm recommending a $5 fee to cover the cost of their advertisement, so it really is a neutral item. Currently, as of January 31st, we had 4,244,782.81 outstanding. We updated over the weekend. As of the end of February, that number had dropped to $2,876,442.12. So we're very rapidly going through that delinquent amount and getting all the money brought in. While I'm before you, I did want to mention our collection rate as it stands this morning is at 95.79%. This same day last year was 95.51, so we're up a little bit off of last year. We've been working very hard to bring the revenue in and get the process going. What I'm requesting from the commissioners this morning is just a motion authorizing the $5 fee and the advertisement of tax liens.
So moved.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, Jeremy.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if you don't mind me saying so while Jeremy's up there, I hope you saw the email, the work that he done. We had a request from the economic developer, Mac Williams, about the breakdown of tax valuations, commercial versus residential. It sounds like a very simple question. Jeremy went above and beyond and his staff in making sure that the information was correct, and I just wanted to publicly thank him and his staff for the work they did on that and getting that information from Mac.
Thank you. And for clarification, the minutes, the motion was for the $5 fee, and the motion also probably should cover that would be in the advertising of the tax liens, and also that we begin collecting the delinquent accounts, which we
exactly.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. All right, item number two, and I hope I pronounce this correct. Is it Pugilee?
Pugilee
building setback waiver. Sons.
All right. These people, the Pugilees, are asking for a waiver of our building setback requirements for their home due to site conditions where there's a large portion of their site is in the floodplain, and this would enable them to put their house up closer to the road to stay as far as they can outside the floodplain. The planning board voted at their last meeting unanimously to approve the waiver.
So moved.
All right.
Just for clarification, this is a replacement home that's going to be placed where the existing home is.
Pretty much so exactly where the
old home is. Not changing anything with respect
not
to setbacks.
Not significantly, no.
And if anybody's familiar with 87, where Travis Creek comes in, that's where the house is, the corner of that, right, and Barber Road. And I've seen the trailer park flooded on the other side several times.
And there's a creek running right behind it.
Yeah, and it's feeding right into it.
The only place you could put it is back where that one came.
It's got to go there. And like she said, the planning board voted unanimously.
Makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I'll second the motion.
All right. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. And Libby, before you leave, can I, ask her one question?
Yes, sir.
And this is about folks that came last week about the racetrack.
Yes, sir.
And we addressed that at the last planning board meeting, and Libby's been doing some work on it. Can you bring the board up to date as to where we are with that?
Certainly. The planning department has moved forward with doing some background research for basically what other racetracks have been doing and what their ordinances have called for on the same item.
Yeah, and we just want the folks that have come before our board to know that we are working on this and
absolutely
trying to come to a neighborly solution out there.
Right.
Thank you. Appreciate it. All right, item number three, East Alamance Bevin 6 Mile Insurance Rated Fire District, Dave Leonard.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman.
Good morning,
Commissioners.
Sir.
You have before you this morning a resolution. I come to you on behalf of Bevin Fire Department, East Alamance Fire Department, asking for this resolution to be signed. As many of you may know, Bevin Fire Department recently opened up a new station. It is located on the southern part of their response district on Bevin Oaks Road near the intersection of Bevin Oaks Road and Old Hillsboro Road. Basically, what this new created 6 Mile district does is it now has their entire response district within a 6 Mile insurance rating district. Prior to this, anyone that lived outside of that 6 Mile rated district had an insurance rating of a 10, which basically is the worst insurance rating you could have. So now with their new station opened up, they now have a 6 Mile true rated fire district. So we ask that this resolution be signed.
So move. I just had one question. Does that increase the number of people who are subject to the fire district tax, or does that stay the same?
That stays the same. That is their rated tax district. This is for insurance purposes.
Just for insurance.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that was interesting about that fire department, the new one, they were able to purchase two new fire trucks. And Dave, you may know this, Piedmont Electric Company.
Yes, sir.
Bought one of the trucks. I think.
Yes, sir.
And they in the process then sold two of their used trucks to these other volunteer fire departments, and it upgraded the equipment. I think these fire departments got them for $1 a piece.
Yes, sir.
So they helped out.
It helped out our other departments community too, departments right? Here in Alamance County. Yes, sir.
It was great. Win-win. Thank you. We do have a motion from Commissioner Smith
second.
For approval. Second. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir. All right, Impact Alamance grant request, item number four, Ms. Wilkinson.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You have before you a request for us to pursue an Impact Alamance grant for the purchase of 10 little libraries. And through this grant, we will purchase the pre-made libraries from freelittlelibraries.org, and then people we'll place them throughout the communities so that books are available outside of the libraries for people to read. We have two in place that a volunteer built for us, one in Mebane and one at Beshmet Park in Elon. And we've stocked those with children's books and like bird identification and plant identification. But when we started that, we had more people want the little libraries than we had them built. So the Impact Alamance grant is to place the books throughout the community, the county at large, and hopefully again spread that love of and joy of reading to the community.
What do they look like?
There are a variety of shapes and sizes. Michelle, you helped pick them out.
It depends on where we're going to place them. So one of them is designed as like a plant seed thing, so you can put seed packets in there. It has plants on as artwork, and then you put the books in them. One's a phone booth, so one's more kid friendly. So it kind of depends on where we're going to place them in the community.
Are they outside or inside?
Outside.
Or both? Outside.
So there is a structure?
Yes, it's
like a lean-to or something?
And it's on a post and then
When we had the ones at the volunteer build, it was interesting because when women would come to the library, they would look at it and say, oh, it's a dollhouse. And when men came to the library and looked at it, they said, oh, it's a giant birdhouse. So they're generally about this big in size, and they go on a post, you know, that people can reach. And they're weatherproofed, so they can sustain being outside. And then we'll have a volunteer that's responsible for maintenance of that little library. And that was kind of the issue that we've had with the one at Beschmidt and the one at the Mebane Park, is maintaining a volunteer to keep that one in good shape and keep it stocked with books that will stock from the donations that we receive.
Are they going to secure these at night, or how is that?
They are open to the public. The concept is that anybody can come in and read a book, and they can take it home with them, and then they can either bring that one back or bring another one from their home and replace it. So it's an honor system.
Okay.
Does the grant pay for everything?
Yes, sir.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. But thank you. Item number five, Ms. Wilkerson, Literacy and Lifelong Learning Grant Application.
That is also me as well. One of the things that we understand in our county is the literacy rate and the need for literacy classes in our county. In our doors, potentially one in five people that come to the library do not have a high school degree. And ACC teaches literacy classes and GED classes, but that's oftentimes, it's not a good central place for people to get to. And we as a library are really looking at our role in the community and feel very strongly that literacy is going to be our mission and our vision, and that encompasses a lot of things. But we have an opportunity to partner with ACC to have literacy classes on a wide range of things, whether it's English as a second language, GED classes, digital literacy, all these types of things, adult literacy, child literacy. We have an opportunity to partner with ACC to have these classes in each of our branches. We started already at Graham. We have a class going on where we're partnering with ACC, where they just come in and use our facilities. And we have seven people that have signed up to take that class. And when they were asked why they wanted to do this, that the answers were varied, but one was they have children and they wanted to set a good example for their child. One person said they wanted to better their lives, and having this GED would help them be able to get a job and better their lives. So we feel very strongly that literacy is something that the libraries need to be involved in. And so through this grant, we will be partnering with ACC to do that more widely than we're able to do it now.
You're just asking us to approve the grant.
To approve for us to pursue the grant. Now, it does involve a $5,000, it's a 10% match, but ACC will match part of that, and we will be responsible for matching $5,000.
Do you have that in your budget now?
I do have that in my designated funds.
So moved.
We have a motion?
Well, I don't know, I was watching something on the TV the other day about the GED equivalencies, how they've raised the bars on those.
They have changed
drastically.
And I think this is something that
needs to be done, because before it was a little quicker to go get a GED, and there's a lot more extensive studying evidently, because they had like a couple college kids couldn't pass it. I mean,
and if you had not finished the previous line of classes for your GED, you have to start over now because of the new structure.
Well, I think this sounds like a great program, and I just, for clarification, the staff, I think there are two different staff resources that would be hired with this grant money, but they would actually be employed by ACC.
That's my understanding, yes, sir.
And then I had a question about the sustainability after the grant period is up. I think that the expectation is that for the, those staff, ACC would continue to employ those, but that wasn't stated in their letter of support. I think their letter of support only covered that first year during the grant period.
Our goal is to try to have this be sustainable, and ACC has committed verbally to that they are very interested in having this continue on as well after the grant runs out, because they also recognize the need for
Well, they do a GED class at ACC, so maybe they can see where they could expand out
and not use more space at the college, right? And because our branches are more centrally located, it's often easier to get to downtown Graham or downtown Burlington or downtown Mebane, especially once Burlington has their transit system. And if that ever expands, then, you know, we will be on routes that will make it easier.
I'll second the motion.
All right. I have a motion from Judge Smith, second. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those no. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck with that.
All right. Item number seven, performance management budgeting. Excuse me, no. Back up to six. World Trade Center Memorial Project, right? Sorry.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
I'm here this morning to ask that the board approve $12,656 in spending from the county's capital reserve fund. These funds would be used to initiate the construction of the World Trade Center Memorial. I've been before the board, and you guys have seen the artist that we've retained, his rendering of what he will do with the cube from the World Trade Center Tower 2. So this time I'm asking you to consider approving funds. The county will give opportunity for any private citizen or business to also help offset the cost of the construction of the piece. We've also had indications from three municipalities, Town of Ossipee, Village of Alamance, and the City of Graham, that they would like to also contribute financially to help offset the cost. But it's going to be up to the county to front these funds to initiate the construction of the piece. We think there will be private citizens, and we've had some business interest. Allie Williams, Carmen and King has already helped us with some in-kind work. They've designed some display boards for us that we've used as we've talked to some of these local governments, and will continue to use. But it's important the board understands we may wind up bearing the, well, we'll bear the entire cost. We've already have some commitment, but it's possible the county would bear the lion's share of the cost of the construction. The current plan, if you approve these funds, would be to have the piece completed by September 11th of this year, at which time it would, for 1 year, travel to fire departments, police departments, CCOM, and EMS, and then be permanently affixed on September 11th, 2016, which is the 15th anniversary of the attack in New York City. So it would go for a year, move from a couple of departments, a couple of fire departments, police departments, for them to host it until it's permanently placed. This piece is really designed to be inside and not moved all the time, but we had a suggestion that it would be an honor for the departments, if it's commissioned, to host it for a little while before it's finally placed. And what we would do if the board today approves the funds to go forward, we'll work through some online websites to give the public and businesses the opportunity to contribute to this. And we've talked about, the board has talked about the possibility of several locations for this piece to be placed. May Memorial Library was one, Historic Courthouse was another, Children's Museum was another. We don't have to come to a conclusion today or for the next several months where it would be located if you want to do it. What I would suggest is you may want to consider the same website where we promote the idea, people can be involved with it. We may give them, if you want to, the opportunity to vote on those three sites or to suggest other sites. That's completely up to the board, of course. You have the authority to just select where it would go. But there would be a lot, I think there's a lot of interest where this will wind up. It may be nice to give the general public an opportunity to comment on that. So at this time, the question before you is to approve $12,656 for the construction of this piece. Hopefully costs would be offset with our cities and private business and private individuals.
So we've taken in $1,500 so far from other municipalities?
That's correct, yes.
So that cuts it, that's from that 12,656, right?
Yes. We have, I believe we've only received actual one payment.
Right.
We have committals for the others.
Right.
What is the amount the person that's doing the artwork that's creating the statute, what are they requesting up front?
The total cost just for Casey Lewis to create the piece is $10,656. I believe he's requesting half of that up front.
Right.
You have to divide it out, but it'd be a little more than $5,000. The additional $2,000 is to create a base. We don't know where the board will pick to place it, so we would want to have a little bit of money to create a base for it, depending on where it goes. And also, what we would want to do with that $2,000 is create a sign that would interpret the piece, explain the figures on the piece, where the cube came from, who is represented, fire, law enforcement, EMS, CCOM, and then also give an opportunity to recognize anyone that donated that wanted to be recognized. I would suggest to the board, if we do that, any donor would get the same amount of recognition for this piece because of the nature of what this is memorializing. So if I gave $1,000, I would get the same listing as someone that might give just a few dollars. But I think we could do that on one sign to keep it from trying to, I don't want to say commercialize the piece, but to give everyone recognition
equal,
that deserves
equal
interest
spot.
But yes, equal recognition.
Well, I have a couple comments and a question. First of all, I think it's a great idea to do this project because this is such a milestone event in our history, and it needs to be kept out in front of future generations. So this will help do that in our local community. Number two, Casey Lewis is an outstanding artist, and he will do a great job. He's done some pieces, major pieces, for the hospital, for Cone Health in Greensboro, and he's just outstanding. But I did have a question about the Capitol Buildings Reserve Fund.
Yes.
What other kinds of things does that compete for those funds?
We have we've used that fund for projects $10,000 or more usually. We have some planned projects. We also have we've used it to replace HVAC systems. It's usually used for capital repairs to buildings. So this is not beyond the pale to use it for this, but this is not typical. This was the only place we had funding to go to look as a possible.
Well, I'm meeting with various departments and the sheriff's department. I know we have some building needs, leaking issues and stuff, so I want to make sure we're able to address those.
We do. We have some pressing needs. I will say that we're working with a couple of groups to come up with a longer range plan for county buildings, particularly since we've moved everybody out of the College Street site. I think we're very close to that. We're actually holding off on a couple of repairs, mainly because we want to come before the board with a proposal, some ideas about where county buildings are moving in the future. So we're kind of on hold with some projects right now because we don't want to invest in a building that we may not use down the road. So
need a plan.
Absolutely. And I think we're very close to having a plan that we can bring before the board. You obviously will have to support it because we won't start moving on that plan until we know Board of Commissioners supports it. Yes, this fund, we do have pressing building needs. I certainly wouldn't want to indicate to you that we don't, but this is the only pot of money that seemed to be applicable without going into a department budget, because it wasn't budgeted anywhere.
There's also an appropriated fund balance. But again, as Brian said, this was the only budgeted place where we thought we could get the funding from.
We do have one more project that I'll be bringing before you, I think, at the next meeting to do some heat and air work in this building that will pretty much wipe that fund out for the year.
So that was my next question. We're probably going to end up spending it all.
Right.
Yes. And then over the past, I think, 2 years, the board has, through the budget process, allocated monies into this fund.
Right.
So I'll be coming to you next meeting with a proposal to do some work in this building that will tap it out.
To me, there should be, once the general public sees what we're doing here, that in terms of the statue and the memorial, that there would be a tremendous outpouring of people that would want to be involved in placing a few dollars, or even businesses and even other public entities to pay for this,
right,
instead of it coming from the county.
I do agree with you on that. I think there would be, because the memorial park down here was funded totally with outside money, no governmental money into that.
Yeah.
I think to get the process started and to ensure that we can have it ready by these dates, we're asking you to consider fronting the money and also being willing to cover any.
Sure.
I agree. I think people will want to be a part of this. I certainly couldn't guarantee that, and the county would have to be prepared to make the difference up between whatever might come in from private business.
is Is there a reason for the dates in terms of having to meet those specific dates, Brian? I mean, because no. We've had this, how long have we had? We've had this piece of metal for how long?
2 years.
2 years, yes. That's what I'm saying.
I think year memorial.
It seemed to be a date to shoot for, the 15th anniversary.
Yeah.
But it's arbitrary.
Right.
As far as it has to be done by that time.
And also, we have a road show that we're ready to go on, so any Rotary Masons, whoever, would like us to go on the road. Last week I was at the village of Alamance. Brian has been to
Town of
Ossipee. So we have a road show that we're ready to go to anybody who would like to consider donations as well.
I think we have a man sitting in this room could probably raise it in 2 or 3 days. He's sitting right behind me. He's our sheriff. Just going out, and I'd certainly be glad to help him. What I'd like to do, if this board is agreeable, is to table this. Let's get out here and see if we can't raise this money ourselves,
right,
from outside
to
of
put
the
it out there.
The county coffers, and we'll help you with that, Brian, if that'd be fine.
I'd
like to make a motion to table.
Well, before we do that, does he have any artist renderings of what his proposal is?
I've
we can post it out and let people
just for
see.
Your knowledge. And we do have, as Craig indicated, we have some presentation that we can do for any group that's interested. Yeah. So if you know I'm going to print it off. I'm sorry, John.
Thank you.
We're happy to come to any club, any service club, talk with them about it. I think we have some up
right
on the,
there,
on the board too. We're, like as Craig mentioned, we're happy. The base is the Twin Tower complex, towers 1 and 2, and then at the bottom, I think that was tower 5. And then the pieces on top represent figures from law enforcement, fire department, CECOM, and EMS. These were all organizations in New York that responded in some form or fashion to the World Trade Center disaster. So the piece really memorializes the public service folks that lost their lives, as well as the civilians that were killed. But and if you look on that one piece of paper with the pictures of folks, those are the people that actually modeled for these, which they are. One was a sheriff's deputy, a CECOM telecommunicator, a paramedic from EMS, and a fireman from, I believe, North Central or the Northeast. I'm sorry, I can't remember. So we have the means to go to talk to any groups, and I know you gentlemen are plugged into the community, so if you know of a group that would possibly be willing to be part of it, be happy to go see them.
I think his board is committed to this project, and I don't see delaying and delaying and delaying anymore. I would say that we approve this amount of money and go out and try to raise the funds, but rather than hold up the plans for this, and it looks like there's an awful lot of interest out in the county with our fire departments and all for it to be done. It's been 2 years and we're still sitting here, and you want to go ahead and why haven't we been raising the money since, you know, for the last 2 years? Because this came up 2 years ago, and I think it's time to just move. So many times we just keep putting things off and putting them off.
And I think, Judge, you just brought up a very good point. Folks been out to raise the money in the last 2 years?
I think it's always been, we're responsible for it because we approved the darn thing, and the commissioner is the one who got this piece of history for the county, and I think it's time to move. I mean, we're basically going to be responsible. $12,000, I mean, if this budget can't stand $12,000, we might as well just pack up and close down.
Right. Further comments?
I tend to agree. I'd be more inclined.
Would you say it was half of the $10,000 we have to commit up front to move forward?
That's correct. Although I will say, in fact, I would rest easier personally if the board approved all the funding and was willing to do that. I'm not telling you have to do that, but if we approve half and Casey begins on the piece and we're not able to raise the other half, which could happen, then I would be coming back to you asking you to consider funding the second half to pay the piece off. It probably would be better, as I would suggest to you, it would be better to approve it all and then let us work to offset the cost as much as we can from clubs. Again, that's just my suggestion. But
Well, I take that as a staff recommendation. So I'd make a motion that we just move forward and approve it. And the only negative I could see about doing that is that if it might be a disincentive for an organization to make
that
a donation.
That, I think, is the problem.
But I think that people are going to want to have their names associated with this piece.
I think so, too. Yeah. Well, there was a previous motion on the floor.
Sorry.
To table. But I will withdraw that motion due to the keen interest by my fellow members of the board. I have a motion and a second that we approve this. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. All right.
Mr. Chairman, in just a brief discussion with our finance officer, her suggestion is that we can just take this out of fund balance. That way, since we have donations coming in, instead of kind of intermingling it with the other, it's just maybe an easier accounting process.
Do we need to amend our motion and vote there?
A motion take the funding out of fund balance.
I'll make a motion. We take it out of fund balance and get out here and raise some money.
So amended motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And the sheriff's itching to say something. Sheriff,
will these donations to this be tax deductible?
They will. The donations will be made to Alamance County, which is you are able to write off.
So right. Okay.
They will make your check to Alamance County.
To Alamance County. Yes, sir.
Put in the memo 911 or Craig County Cuts.
Don't say that.
And it'll be a tremendous outpouring, and it is this endeavor is certainly one. I mean, this is something that affected all our lives.
Right. And it's history, and we need it.
And I assure you, we will work to let the public and our business community know this opportunity to be a part of this exists.
And they will be noted and have recognition for their contributions.
Absolutely. And hopefully, our media friends will help us get that word out. I know they've done pieces about it. But I'd be appreciative if we could maybe have a little new piece about it too.
And again, anybody that does want to request us to make a presentation to any group, we will be more than happy to.
Could the county do a letter explaining what we did that we could send to?
Absolutely.
To the businesses and so forth, people. Yeah.
Any further discussion?
No, that's good.
Thank you, Brian. Appreciate it.
All right. Did we vote on taking it out of fund balance?
Yes, we did.
I guess
we did.
Kind of got me.
We took care of it, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Well, I'm number seven. Brian is still up. Performance Management Budget Program Spending Proposal.
Commissioners, at this time, I'm requesting that the Board of Commissioners approve spending performance management savings in order to fund spending plans from six Alamance County departments. You should have in your package a list of those departments and a description of the items they are proposing to buy. The current performance management policy allows departments to bank saved funds from their annual budgets to spend for items that are defined in the policy as new equipment, vehicles, capital improvements, buildings, or employee bonuses. The last time county departments were able to pay out was in December of 2014. The majority of those funds at that time were paid for county employee bonuses. The current total balance of performance management funds, now this is across all departments, not just these six, is $644,842.52. The six departments that you have lists of items for, the total they are requesting to spend at this time is $295,218.03. This will leave a balance in performance management savings, which is in designated fund balance, I believe, of $349,624.49. Again, that's across the spectrum. That is not just for those six departments. If you have any specific questions about items that the departments have listed, I'll be happy to try to answer them. We also have some department heads here, too, that I'm sure could answer them for you. Or if you have any questions about the policy or about this process, I'll be happy to try to answer them. I will tell you that county management has reviewed the proposed spending plans from the departments and found that their requests meet the terms of the policy. So.
All right. Questions?
I have a question about the program.
Commissioner Burke.
Yes, sir.
I read through it, and I wasn't sure about the dollar value of what's available maximum and how it relates to the fund balance. So I see a figure 8%
Yes, sir.
So what's, explain that 8%.
The policy allows departments at the end of the fiscal year, if they had savings, they have, there's some reductions that have to be made to that savings. But at the end, they can retain some portion of their savings from their budget. But, and they can bank it and
so,
carry it
so
over.
This is after the fiscal year is over?
Yes, sir.
So if they're budgeted for $1 million and they only spent $800,000, then they have $200,000 that they can do something with?
Yes. Now, but the policy has some things that kick in and start taking some of that $200,000 away. But let's say they walked away with $100,000. That's pretty accurate. About half of the savings stays with the department. But then the funds can also be banked and roll over to the next fiscal year. So they don't have to be spent immediately. They can start saving. But the 8%, that's a cap. The department cannot bank more than 8% of its budget. So
a million-dollar department can't bank any more than 800, or, I mean, 80,000.
Yes, 80,000.
That's correct. If they were able to save more in their bank than 80,000, that difference goes to the county. It's fund balance. So they can only carry that. It's to keep, it's to encourage the departments to buy things they need and to go ahead and spend their money on items that they need to buy. But that's the reason behind the 8% cap. They can't carry forward any more than that.
So the 8% only relates to what they can carry forward, not about what they can spend for that, the year in which they earn that savings.
Yes, sir. It's only on, the 8% only applies to what they can carry forward, the total amount. They can spend, if they carried $80,000 forward, if they wanted to spend $80,000 on a couple of new cars, that would be an acceptable purchase that would have to be approved by the board, but it could be done. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. Thank you.
Further comments?
Another question.
Yes, sir.
So what protects the entire fund balance? So what's the protections there?
The policy has some percentages in place. The county has to have at least a 12% fund balance, which, you know, 8%, I believe, is a recommendation for the local government commission.
Well, that's the bottom. Yeah. That's the floor before we get a letter, right?
Right.
Yes.
Right.
So, and then currently, isn't it something like 21% or something?
Right. Mm-hmm. Not sure what our current is. About 20 to 21%.
23, I think, is the average for counties our size.
For our size, or maybe it was more than that.
Yeah. When the policy was enacted, we were very low in fund balance.
Yeah, right. We were down.
So the policy has some stipulations in it that says the county must be at 12% for this even to come into effect. And up till 12%, all savings. County departments are the only entities that are funded by county government that return money at the end of the year. Okay, so, you know, you give money to a lot of outside agencies, but they don't return their savings. If they have savings,
they use them.
They have it. They keep it. County departments, they give it back. So if at the end of the fiscal year, if the county was at 11%, this policy would not kick in. It kicks in at 12% fund balance, but there's an immediate 25% reduction from the department's savings at 12% because the commissioners at the time felt like that was still a rather weak position, financial health. It doesn't kick in at its full capacity until the county is at least 15% fund balance. So if we're at 15% fund balance, the policy in its entirety kicks in and departments could possibly recover all their money, but there are some things that their goals kick in. If they didn't make all their goals, they start losing money. If they didn't cover all their revenue, we start taking money from them. So if a department projected $1 million in revenue and only brought in $800,000, we start taking that missed revenue because that helped balance the budget. So if the department missed revenue, it's hard to let them have that savings when they, you know, missed the revenue. So we work that in too.
So right now there is a total balance of $645,000 for this program.
Yes, and that is across all 24 departments in various amounts.
And our total fund balance is how much?
It's about 21%.
So this is not a big proportion of our fund balance.
Right, and as Brian said, one of the things that we've talked about among staff is we may want to look at tweaks. I think there's some concern now about maybe changing and upping the percentage of fund balance to get to that 24%.
Yeah.
But what we have right now is based on the current approved policy. And there are some changes we want to look at with respect to expenditures as well. You're not allowed travel and training at this time under performance base. And there's been a lot of requests from department heads to have some travel and training incurred for that. But again, I think the most interesting thing, if you look at a lot of the requests by department heads and some of the capital needs, they probably would not have been funded in a regular budget cycle. There are needs that are there, especially for vehicles. There are needs that are there, but we've never had any additional funding to fund those capital vehicle needs. And this is allows them to use their savings to do things that they think is necessary.
Well, I like it because it gives department heads some discretion about how to control their budgets and how to spend some money. Yep. And so, I mean, I think it's a good program.
And that was the general idea.
I just wanted to make sure I understood.
Yeah.
Based on Commissioner Smith's questions last time, right. I just kind of made me think of some questions.
I'll always give my favorite example is Kathy Holland here.
No.
Kathy Holland always, since I've been here, put a minivan in her budget for an expenditure. An easy capital cut for a manager, that's $25,000 that we don't need. Now you don't need it, just use old sheriff's car. Her argument has always been with the amount of people during elections that we take people back and forth to polls, we carry a lot of equipment, we carry a lot of ballots, we carry a lot of this, we carry a lot of that. It is a necessary expenditure. County manager said no, it wasn't. Well, now with performance-based budgeting, she has that opportunity to say, this is a necessary expenditure for me to do my job. And that's what we need to spend our funding on. So.
Any
I agree, and I was on the board when we put this in effect, and I think it does give the department heads that autonomy to go out and do what they need to do, because they're in their own world every day and know what needs to be done. Where Craig, he's over here in the Empire. But anyhow, it does give those department heads a little bit of a leeway to find things they need to do and get buy-in from all their people.
I'll be very soon, since we have the audit back. I've been working with Susan. I've been going through the 13-14 budget, so I'll be bringing to you an annual report for 13-14 fiscal year goal report, as well as a report on what kind of savings the department's produced and were able to retain from that fiscal year too. So that'll be in the next couple of months.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll move that we accept the recommendation.
I'll second it.
All right. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no?
No.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. Discussion of Hallfield's economic development zone recommendations. County manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As the board's aware, we had a joint meeting with the cities of Graham and Mebane approximately a week and a half ago, and there were some specific recommendations that were offered at that time, and if the board would like, I would be glad to read them to you. Number one, we would approve the name of the Hallfields Economic Development Zone as the North Carolina Commerce Park. Number two, we appoint the Chamber of Commerce as our representative to work with property owners to negotiate and open an option to sell their land, and also they will do the marketing and site certification for us. Number three, we would appropriate $300,000 total. That would be $100,000 from the county, $100,000 from Mebane, and $100,000 from Graham. That would be associated with expenses for site certification, options, and marketing that we would forward to the chamber for expenditure. The fourth thing, we would approve the creation by Graham and Mebane an overlay zoning district that will maintain development standards within the park. Right now, part of it's in Graham, part of it's in Mebane. We need to have something that's very consistent for the entire 1,200 acres. Number five, the organizational structure for the North Carolina Commerce Park will be the Oversight Committee for the administration of future activities and operations. Right now, the board has appointed myself and Clyde Albright as your representatives to that committee. The other municipalities have appointed their staff as well. But number five or six, require the Oversight Committee to provide a semi-annual report and accounting of the revenues, expenditures, and activities of the North Carolina Commerce Park in April and October of each year. So that way we'll be able to look at where we're at for budget time moving forward with the Commerce Park. And again, $300,000 is not projected to be spent all in one year either. It's just to give the chamber and MAC a little bit of leeway and funding on how to do the site certification. And these were recommendations that were really a consensus at that time from MEB and Graham and this board, but now we are looking for formal approval. And if there's any questions, be glad to answer.
Do we need to address each one individually, maybe? Because we're spending money in here, too, so.
We can either do it individually or as a whole, either or.
I like the whole package. I thought, first of all, I'd like to thank Chairman Engel for doing such a great job of representing us and chairing the whole joint meeting. I thought it went very well, and I just love the collaboration that we have going on this project. And I think this project is so important for economic development. And I'll never forget going to a chamber retreat about, 5 or 6 years ago, and was on economic development. And one of the guest speakers was the consultant that Honda Aero used to determine, to help them find the suitable location for Honda Aero. And he went through the process that companies like Honda Aero go through in selecting a site for where they're going to put their business. And everything that we're talking about in this project, those high priority items, shovel ready land, having a community that's working together so they don't have to go through the trouble in a multi-municipality community like ours and trying to
work.
Yeah, it's very complicated. And and make, you know, the whole concept of this being a certified site, I just think that it's great. And I'm in favor of this. I'll make the motion that we adopt all the recommendations.
I'd like to say I think the staffs have done a great job on this project. I think it's absolutely a good idea, and I second your motion. I think all of the recommendations are reasonable and been well thought out, and this is a project we need to move on and quit sitting around waiting and finding some reason to delay everything. It seems to come up. It's just necessary, and we've got to do it.
Ditto.
There you go, Judge.
We have a motion. And
well,
we
can
a,
I
yes,
speak
sir,
to
sorry.
Just one second? Yes, on the $100,000, I think it needs to be clarified that money will not be like up fronted to the chamber. It's kind of as needed.
Well, the thought process is to give them the upfront. However, it will be set in aside in a special North Carolina Commerce Park fund.
Okay.
And with separate accounting. This is not going to subsidize any chamber activities, any ribbon cuttings. This is specifically for the North Carolina Commerce Park.
Okay.
So, and there will be a true accounting that you'll see as far as the expenditures, and the Oversight Committee will review those. And again, we'll make you will be presenting reports on those expenditures as well.
Yeah, because one of the things that came up at the meeting when I asked, we're looking at a year out probably before they can actually do the certification if everything works.
So. Well, and I do want to reiterate this is really a partnership not only with Mevin and Graham but also with landowners. And again, want to reiterate our support of trying to market and bring them a part of the process as we move forward, that this is not big government coming in saying we're taking your property.
Right.
We're trying to enhance their property that will give them the marketability to sell, and we think that industrial and manufacturing is the highest and best use of that property.
Well, it was very impressive from their map that only a couple tracks were pretty much said we don't want to be involved out of so many acres of land.
1,200 left. Yeah, we did have a couple that said no. Everybody else said yes, or two said yes with a little bit of reservations or clarifications. So it's a very... Everybody really is working together.
And the ones that said no really won't have any adverse impact.
No adverse impact at all.
It was, the meeting was well attended.
It was.
In Mebane by landowners, and the three respective boards were unanimous in their, well, consensus.
Taking it back to their board.
Yeah, we're taking it back, and with items A through F that we're, we have a motion and a second to vote on. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, if I could also say, this is probably the third meeting we've had with the landowners present, and there was not a lot of comment from the landowners.
Right.
That they seemed like they were fully engaged and aware of what we were trying to do, and that really made me feel good, that they felt that they were part of the process and we were not doing anything new that they were not aware of, because there was not a lot of comment from the landowners.
And correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't their commitment to a 2 years to this as we go forward?
The thought process is there's a cost for the certification. And if you are willing to be part of the project, you're going to have to give us an option for 2 years. And that's how long the site certification lasts. After 2 years, you do have to do a recertification. But again, if you're wanting us to spend the money for the site certification, you've got to commit to us that you're part of this for a minimum of 2 years.
Okay, that's good.
Thank you. We do have a motion and a second. All those in favor of items A through F that were passed on to us by the Economic Development Committee, certify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. Thank you. Going to item number 9, resolution in support of local bill to allow Alamance County to extend voting machine implementation.
The chairman and I attended a Board of Elections meeting, and as the board's aware of, the state is looking at reverting back to paper ballots. We do not have paper ballots. The cost to revert back our machines and buying new machines is about $1.6 million, if I'm aware of.
Yeah.
Our machines are in good working order. We've not had problems or issues or concerns. There's been no concern from the Board of Elections. There's been no concerns from the Election Board. I really do appreciate Representative Rydell for being at the meeting. And we've asked that he, with this resolution, that it would delay the implementation of those new voting machines in Alamance County. The date is
2020,
January 1, 2020. That would give us the life expectancy out of our current machines. We would have to probably buy new machines by 2020, but we don't need to buy them before that time. So that would allow us the time to put some money into a capital fund. It would allow us to get full usage. The buyback on these machines now are about $50,000. And so there is really no monetary value to the existing over 120 some machines.
50,000 total.
50,000 total, yes, sir.
Yeah.
On a $1.6 million purchase.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Judge. Motion, sir. That was an easy,
that was easy one right there.
Well, I like it.
Representative Rydell is ready and willing and able to carry that bill through the
Did they have an estimated cost on what we're looking at here?
$1.6 million.
Oh, yes.
That's ridiculous.
I did not understand that legislation. We discussed it at the
yeah.
North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, and that group, it was up for discussion as a body to recommend that part of the law be changed back, but it didn't get through, and I just didn't understand the reasoning.
It seems like every 3 or 4 years that legislature wants to change the voting machines in 100 counties.
And I've cost
been through
the
for almost
money.
20 years,
yeah.
And it's $1 million here and $1 million there.
And Raleigh, that's not a lot of money, Judge. Evidently.
And the rest of the story is right now, Judge, they've got one vendor. Imagine that, one vendor that's been approved by the state. Well, that's
all I can think of is Chad's.
Well, we do have a motion and a second. I'll second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
And I will say that the most interesting thing, well, we sat through a presentation with the vendor. They're still using electronics to count and calculate the balance. You know, so it was a mess. So,
need to get the life out of those machines if we can, so I'm hopeful that Representative Rydell and Ross and Senator Gunn can get that done for us. So, and, all right, that completes our business. County Manager's report.
Do have a small video that the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners have asked that we review, and I will watch this.
Showtime.
It's just showtime. Bring out the popcorn.
I'd like to welcome you to the NCACC
date
for February 20.
I don't think it's a very good idea for this.
basically wanted to talk about legislative goal setting meeting. We're in the process now of trying to get a joint meeting for this board to meet with Representative Ross, Representative Rydell, and Senator Gunn. So we'll try to do that in a morning time, trying to get on their calendar as well. But it was a very, very, very good process. And this was really just an update on that and encouraging us to meet with our delegation.
When is the deadline for filing local bills? It's coming up. Is it, it's in March, isn't it?
Not sure.
16th or 17th, maybe. 16th. So we're going to have to expedite that, yeah, that local bill.
And the only other thing that I wanted to mention is Wednesday morning at 9:30 is our first joint facilities meeting subcommittee with the Alamance Burlington School System. And we will meet in here. Very simply to start with, it'll be like our original joint meeting with them. The superintendent will give a presentation. I'll give a presentation. We'll talk about process. Then we'll talk about setting dates moving forward. So trying to give really the citizens, the six citizens will be participating, kind of bring them up to speed where we're at.
Sounds good. Anything further?
That's all I have.
All right. Thank you, sir. Commissioner's comments.
I have one issue.
All right, sir.
I'd like manager to tell us where we are on this IT breakdown.
We are in the process of meeting with all departments, and all departments have been met with to see what data has been lost, see what we need to do recovery, see where the breakdown was.
How long has this been going on?
The event was January 26th was the day that.
And we haven't, there's been no investigation yet?
We have been ever
Why
since.
Why are we still investigating? We don't have any answers?
We do. We know what happened, and we know what data was lost and what functions we lost. We're now going through MIS to try to figure out how best to back those up. We actually have a group here today meeting with the MIS department. We're going to meet with Craig and myself, talk about, we were able to find some very high priority data and functions that we have to back up immediately.
Why wasn't this done to begin with, is what I want to know.
That's what we're trying.
We don't know yet. We're trying to.
There are processes that were not in place.
You know, I know most of the people in MIS, and they are really good people. But this is actual incompetence, and something needs to be done about it. Somebody needs to be discharged or demoted or something. And this is absolutely absurd. The rumors I hear is EMS has lost somewhere $25,000 to $50,000 that will not be recovered. Now, folks, you make a mistake like that in the private business, and you're going to be gone.
Well, I will say, I think what this has pointed out is that we absolutely have to do a better job backing up our data and our functions, because we had a number of functions that we lost, particularly in CECOM, when this thing went down. But we have met with every department, categorized everything that was lost, functions and data. And we are working with MIS right now to ensure this never happens again, and what they need to do to make sure the functions can continue. If things will break, we know that. But we've got to have a better setup.
So most of the time has been spent getting the damage. How much damage has been done, is that right?
Yes.
But nobody, including the head of MIS, can tell you what happened and why it happened. Is that what we're looking at?
Well, we've met with MIS, and they had a firm come in to help them do this update. We've met with the folks from the firm. Right.
Don't we have a backup in Ohio or somewhere, or Raleigh? It used to be in Ohio, and now it's in Raleigh to always back up there? What happened to that?
My understanding is at this time we are only backing up locally in this building. So that's what we're going to change. We're going to have to change.
We're only backing up the departments in this building. Well,
my understanding is after we've sat with MIS and the groups that have helped them put together these systems, the only backup is being done in this building for all of county government's data and functionality. That's what has to change. Am I correct?
We are, and we our plan is to bring a recommendation back to this board. That there's some low-hanging fruit that should have been done, and that's what we're trying to see, what processes and procedures should have been done, what we need to do for long term. But again, as Brian said, we met with Davenport last week, who helped with the upgrade. There was some data conversion problems. We didn't do a good job, but we are addressing it, and we will submit a full report to the board once we get what happened, next steps, and how we move forward in the future. But
look, I'm not blaming senior management on this. I mean, you're just like we all are. We expected MIS to be able to handle this problem. Department heads are not to be blamed for this. MIS is to be blamed for this, and somebody needs to pay. I'm sorry. We need to send the message out. We don't allow and don't expect to have incompetence in any of our departments, and that's ridiculous. So I'm not jumping.
No.
I know where the problem is, and everybody knows where the problem is, and it's about time something.
Thank you, Judge. In terms of accountability, have you established who is it? Accountable for this, sir.
There is a responsibility with MIS. There's responsibility with Davenport. There's responsibility with Dell. So we're trying to deal with that. We're also having a consultant come in to look at where our functions and policies are short, and for him to make recommendations on next steps and how we make sure we're organized right to move MIS where it needs to be.
And we have identified through this the absolute priority data that has to be backed up in addition to what's being done in our building right now. That's what they're doing today, is listing out for us. There were certain things like EMS and the records that you referenced. We do need a long-term solution for how to better back up, but we know that has to be done immediately.
Right.
We have to be able to provide those records to the hospital or whoever wants them. So we're trying to figure out right now today how best to do that short term right now. And there's a few other functions too that are in that same group, that high priority.
Right.
How do you back it up? We're working on that today.
For the record,
is the tax department involved, Jeremy?
We had some minor problems, mostly having to do with email, just a little bit of internet connectivity. The fortunate thing is that we have a separate server. So we're running an AS400 server totally separate. It was not affected.
That helps.
For the record, who else lost data?
Every single department lost something. It was primarily emails, the ability to email, as well as any emails they sent out. Any documents they may have worked on that day that's on the county server, if they went in and edited a document, those edits were lost. I didn't bring it in with me, but we have prioritized most of the priority, and I just want to speak to that because there was a lot. It has taken almost 3 to 4 weeks to sit down with every department and go through what did you lose. The priorities were with emergency services. That's where, like for example, the sheriff's officers were unable to log into their computers in their cars that morning due to the server being down. Well, that's a priority.
They put them in danger.
Yes, that is a priority without question to figure out how to better back up. How to make sure when they get in the car, if one server's down, there's some other way for them to use their onboard computers. the patient care records. CCOMS functionality, they lost a few of their functions, their EMD, EFD, the ability to dispatch calls using some protocols that they use through the computer. They lost that, had to go to some manual setups. And I think the final really large data loss was in Department of Social Services. You know, when they get a client come in, apply for service, they require data from that client to demonstrate their income and things like that. Normally they scan it into Compass or Compass. Well, those were, from that Monday, that was all lost, right? All those hard copies were lost, and they were just either destroyed or given back to the client, saved to the system, but the data was lost in the system. We know that. That did increase the workload for Susan's folks having to go back and contact all those people that came in that Monday. So we've prioritized those functions. That's the first step. Those things have got to be backed up immediately.
Susan, have you been able to recoup anything?
Not out of the system. We had workers, so all their documentation they put into the system on Monday for interviews, for sexual abuse interviews, and all that was lost. So they had to, staff had to go back. So that day was lost, and then, you know, another day piecing it back together and putting it in again. We also, you know, when we take a hotline call, it's immediately typed in and saved on the server. So we, you know, we're able to recreate most of those for child abuse and adult protective services, but we did have some situations that it was an anonymous caller, and we were unable to piece some of that together.
And the risk there is that's, you know, Susan, I'm sure would tell you, those are adult protective and child protective mm-hmm. service calls that, fortunately, as she said, they got most of the data and were able to follow up. There were a couple that you know, we weren't able to. So, I mean, this is, I can assure you, right. I think I'm speaking for Craig here probably, but I've been particularly working with this. It is high priority, and there's nothing much higher going on right now for us.
This has really consumed us really for the last 3 weeks. This has been our top priority to work with Davenport to see why it happened, to work with our departments to see what processes need to be in place, that wasn't in place, and so what do we do now moving forward? But also working to see what was lost and to see how we can do it. But I like I said, when this meeting is over, Brian and I have a meeting with Davenport to look at how we move forward. So, but it's a top priority.
I would suggest just keeping the board apprised.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Judge, for bringing that up. I think it needs to be addressed. Yeah. And I'm assuming the next meeting we'll have some answers.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
I don't have anything.
Anything, Judge? You finished? A couple things.
What today?
we've Sheriff want me to advise folks that we have one deputy that was killed in the line of duty back in 1934. His name was George Jefferson Massey. It was March 4th of 1934, out in Glencoe, while he was working a motor vehicle accident, he was hit and killed. He is not on the, in Washington, D.C., on the Monument of Honor of all law enforcement killed in the line of duty. They're going to be placing him there this year. In view of that, Sheriff Johnson and his folks, his honor guard, they're going to be honoring Deputy Massey out at Union Ridge Cemetery on this coming Wednesday at 11 a.m. They were out practicing in the snow. When was that, Sheriff? Friday?
Yes, sir.
That's right. He's sick now. You know, I went by there and I stopped and they were out practicing in the snow that morning and everything was canceled. And we appreciate that, Sheriff. We appreciate what you're doing. But we'll make that announcement and that pretty much takes care of it. I don't have anything else. If there's no further from the commissioners, meeting adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the Commissioners' meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.